नेक्स्ट सब टॉपिक इज प्रोसेस शेड्यूलिंग. मल्टी प्रोग्रामिंग ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम अलाउ मोर देन वन प्रोसेस टू बी लोडेड इन टू द एग्जीक्यूटेबल मेमोरी एट अ टाइम एंड फॉर द लोडेड प्रोसेस टू शेयर द सीपीयू यूजिंग टाइम मल्टीप्लेक्सिंग. The scheduling mechanism is the part of process management manager that handles the removal of the running process from the CPU and the selection of another process on the basis of particular strategy. The objective of multiprogramming is to have some process running at all times so as to maximize CPU utilization. The objective of time sharing is to switch a processor core among processes so frequently that users can interact with each program while it is running. To meet these objectives, the process scheduler selects an available process, possibly from a set of several available processes for program execution on a core. Each CPU core can run one process at a time. For a system with a single CPU core, there will never be more than one process running at a time. Whereas a multi-core system can run multiple processes at one time. If there are more processes than core, excess processes will have to wait until a core is free and can be rescheduled. The number of processes currently in memory is known as the degree of multiprogramming. Balancing the objective of multiprogramming and time sharing also requires taking the general behavior of process into account. In general, most processes can be described as either I/O bound or CPU bound. An I/O bound process is one that spends more of its time during doing I/O operations than it spends doing computations. A CPU bound process, in contrast, generates I/O requests infrequently using more of its time doing computations. Let us see the scheduling queues. As processes enter the system, they are put into a ready queue where they are ready and waiting to execute on a CPU's core. This queue is generally stored as a linked list. A ready queue header contains pointer to the first PCB in the list, and each PCB includes a pointer field that points to the next PCB in the ready queue. As we know that every process have a PCB, and we know the contents of the PCB also. The first field of the PCB is pointer. Now this pointer points to the next PCB, so it is just like a linked list where it have a header and a tail. Header points to the next PCB, head pointer points to the next PCB, and this PCB also have head pointer, or we can say pointer, that points to the next PCB, and tail pointer points to the last PCB in the linked list. It is a simple data structure. This PCB is nothing but a data structure, as we had seen the structure of the PCB. Each PCB includes a pointer field that points to the next PCB in the ready queue. The system also includes other queues like wait queue. When a process is allocated a CPU core, it executes for a while and eventually terminates, is interrupted, or waits for the occurrence of a particular event, such as completion of an IO request. In a process state diagram, we had seen that. Suppose the process makes an IO request to a device such as disk. Since devices run significantly slower than processors, the process will have to wait for the IO to become available. Processes that are waiting for a certain event to occur, such as completion of IO, these are placed in a wait queue. So there are two queues available. One is ready queue, another is wait queue. So these two queues are available in the scheduling queues. Let us see the scheduling queues. A common representation of scheduling queue is this one, that is called as queuing diagram. This is a queuing diagram. Two types of queues are present. One is ready queue, and these are the wait queues. This is wait queue, this is wait queue, and this is also wait queue. This is may be considered wait queue because time slice expired. As we know that whenever the new process is created, that will put to the ready queue. These circles represent the resources. This processor is a resource, IO is a resource, then some IO operations performed by the child process, that also goes under the resource, but actually this is a process, this also a process. These two circles, CPU and IO, considered as resources. This arrow and rest of the arrows, all these arrows are flow of processes in the system. This flow of process from the newly generated process that put into the ready queue. For example, P0, then P1, like this, the processes are put in a queue. Now here, the process P2 is processed and executing by processor, this P2. Now suppose this P2 requires some IO operation. At that time, it will preempt and it will provide to the IO wait queue. Now here, P2 will available in the already available queue. So there may be some processes available, maybe. For example, P4 process is already available. So after the P4, P2 will join to this IO wait queue, because P2 requires IO request, and after it performs the IO operation, that again put into the ready queue, and after the ready queue, that goes to the process again, and if the IO completion or all the operations of this process P2 completes, then it will exit. So this is the scheduling queues. A new process is initially put in the ready queue. This new process is put in the ready queue. It waits until there until it is selected for execution or dispatch to the process. Once the process is allocated a CPU core and is executing, one of the several event may occurs. As we discussed earlier here, that if the process is executing, some events may occurs, like the process could issue an IO request and then be placed in a IO queue. Another event may be the process could create a new child process. This one child process, one process may spawns number of processes. So that process, lightweight processes again, that is called as child process. So that creates a new child process and then be placed in a wait queue. Queue while it awaits the child's termination. So after the completion of child process, after execution of child process, that process may again go to the ready queue. That event may occur. The process could be removed, another event, that process could be removed forcibly if interrupt occurs. If interrupt occurs, then that will put into the ready queue, wait queue, and from the waiting queue, it wait for its turn and again put into the ready queue. Or having its time slice expired. For 5 milliseconds, for example, I am taking example, for 5 milliseconds, suppose that time slice is given. After 5 milliseconds, that process executes, then it expires its time limit, that is 5 milliseconds. So it put into the wait queue. So it will put back into the ready queue after the time occurs. So this is a simple scheduling queues. What happens in the first two cases? Means this IO request and this child process, creating child process and wait for an interrupt. In these two cases, the process eventually switches from the waiting state to the ready state and is then put back into the ready queue. A process continues this cycle until it terminates. This continues until it terminates normally, at which time it is removed from all the queues and has its PCB and resources deallocated. Also, after the completion of all the processes by this processor, for example P2, then it also removes its PCB. As we know that process may be in one of two states, running state or not running state. So here let us see the schedulers. How scheduling happens? When new process is created by operating system, that process enters into the system in the running state. Processes that are not running are kept in queue, waiting their turn to execute. Each entry in the queue is a pointer to a particular process. Queue is implemented by using linked list, as we seen earlier. Use of dispatcher is also there. When a process interrupted, that process is transferred in the waiting queue. that also we have seen. If the process has completed or aborted, the process is discarded. That means it is terminated and it is exit. In either case, the dispatcher then select a process from the queue to execute. So here, how it happens? Here, schedulers are there, which schedules all these things. These scheduler are of three types: long-term scheduler, short-term scheduler, and medium-term scheduler. What is long-term scheduler? It is also called job scheduler. Long-term scheduler determines which programs are admitted to the system or processing. Job scheduler selects processes from the queue and loads them into memory for execution. Process loads into the memory for CPU scheduler. The primary objective of job scheduler means long-term scheduler is to provide a balanced mix of jobs such as IO bound and processor bound. It also controls the degree of multiprogramming. If the degree of multiprogramming is stable, then the average rate of process creation must be equal to the average departure rate of process leaving the system. On the same system, the long-term scheduler may be absent or minimal. Time-sharing operating system have no long-term scheduler. When process changes the state from new to ready, then there is a long-term scheduler. What is short-term scheduler? Or this is called as CPU scheduler. It is also called as CPU scheduler. Main objective is increasing system performance in accordance with the chosen set of criteria. It is the change of ready state to running state of the process. CPU scheduler selects from among the processes that are ready to execute and allocates the CPU to one of them. Short-term scheduler, also known as dispatcher, executes most frequently and makes the fine-grained decision of which process to execute next. Short-term scheduler is faster than long-term scheduler. Lastly, the third type of scheduler is medium-term scheduler. Medium-term scheduler is part of swapping function. For that purpose, we must understand the swapping. Swapping means putting the process outside the memory and put the process inside the memory. So that is called as swap in and swap out. We'll see this swapping process in detail in next upcoming lectures. It removes the process from the memory, means put into the memory and removes from the memory. It reduces the degree of multiprogramming. The medium term scheduler is in charge of handling the swapped out processes. Running processes may become suspended by making an IO request. Sometimes it may be possible. Suspended processes cannot make any progress towards completion. That always, we can say it is a discarded process, suspended process. In this condition, to remove the process from memory and make space for other processes, it's called as swapping. Suspended process is moved to the secondary storage, that is a hard disk, that is called as swapping. From hard disk to the memory and from memory to the hard disk, this process, in and out process, is called as swapping. It is rolled out swapped out or it is called as rolled out. Swapping may be necessary to improve the process mix. So here the scheduler have a swap in medium term. If I talk about the medium term, this diagram is specially for queuing diagram with medium term scheduler. Swap in process is there. Swap in. So take a data from RAM into the ready queue. Partially executed swapped out processes that will be go outside out of the memory. So this particular swap in and swap out process is handled by the medium term scheduler. Let us see context switch. This is the last subtopic of this topic. As we know that interrupts cause the operating system to change a CPU core from its current task to run a kernel routine. Such operations happen frequently on general purpose systems. When an interrupt occurs, the system needs to save the current context of the process running on the CPU core so that it can restore that context when its processing is done, essentially suspending the process and then resuming it. The context is represented in the PCB of the process. It includes the value of the CPU registers, the process state, and memory management information. Generally, we perform a state save of the current state of the CPU core, be it in kernel or user mode, and then a state restore to resume operations. Means switching the CPU core to another process requires performing a state save of the current process and a state restore of a different processes. This task is known as context switch, or in simple language I can say that when any interrupt occurs and that process is to be put into the wait queue or waiting queue, at that time it must save its current status or current state so that when it goes into the ready state again, then it must start from that point where it goes in the wait state. From that point where it suspends. Now the time comes to resume the process again. So at that time the process state must be saved so that it can be restored while it resumes. Switching the process core to another process requires performing a state save of the current process and a state restore of a different processes. This task is known as context switch. It is illustrated in this diagram. Let us see this diagram, this figure, where the two processes are there, process P1, P0 and process P1, where process P0 is executing. Let us see this example. Process P0 is now executing. When a contest switch occurs, the kernel saves the context of the old process in its PCB and loads the saved context of the new process scheduled to run. So here process P0 and P1 is taken as an example of the old process and a new process. Context switch time is pure overhead because the system does not useful work while switching. Switching speed varies from machine to machine. So depending on the memory speed, the number of registers that must be copied, and the existence of the special instructions such as single instructions to load or store all registers. Typical speed is several microseconds. Context switch times are highly dependent on hardware support. For instance, some processors provides multiple set of registers. A context switch here simply requires changing the pointer to the current register set. There are more active processes than register set. The system restores resources to copying register data to and from the memory as before. Also, the more complex the operating system, the greater the amount of work that must be done during a context switch. Now, here I am taking this example actually, process P0 and P1. Process P1 in execution, and after some times, after this point, it requires IO operations. For example, it requires IO operations so that it goes in interrupt or some system calls. So when it requires some IO operations or some event to occur at that time, it must save the current state into its PCB. We know that this process have PCB 0, this process P1 have PCB 1. So after this point, this is the current state. It saves its current state into the PCB 0. And then operating system recognizes that it requires some IO operations. So up to this one, the process P1 was idle. It checks whether the P0 is in a execution mode or not. In execution, that means in running state or not. No, it is not in running state now. So operating system will load another process, that is P1, which was idle in the up to this point. So it reloads the state from PCB1. The status of this process P1 is already saved into PCB1. So it restores, or we can say it reloads, operating system reloads the state of P1 from PCB. And as soon as it reloads, P1 starts executing from this point. Up to this point, suppose. Now, suddenly, after this point, this process P1 also requires some IO operations. That means this P1 also preempts. Preempts means it will taken off. As soon as it taken off, saves the status or saves the current state. Current state is this one into the PCB1. PCB1 belongs to P1. or we can say P1 have PCB1. So obviously it store or save the current state into PCB1. Operating system saves. Now it becomes idle. This particular area, time period becomes idle of P1. Up to what? Until the process P0 starts executing. Now it completes its IO operation. Suppose, for example, this P0 also completes its IO operation. Now it requires execution. So that operating system will allocate the CPU to P0. So for that purpose, operating system must reload the state from the PCB0 of P0. So we can say it reloads the state from PCB0. Operating system reloads this one, and then this process P0 starts executing. It starts executing. Till then, this process P1 becomes idle because there is no, it may be busy in IO operation or any event occurred related with the P1. So switching from P0 to P1 and P1 to P0, that means a processor will allocate to P0, as well as after some time this allocates to P1. I am taking just a two process example. There are many processes. So switching from one state, from one process to another process, or allocating the processor to P0, P1, P2, P3, like this one. So it's called as context switching. This context switching is highly dependent on hardware support. Means some processor provides multiple set of registers, so it may requires some time to restore or to reload and to save. So that is dependent, hardware dependent. Now see the reflection question. What is ready queue contents? Can you guess it? Okay, correct. The ready queue contains all the processes that are ready to execute and are waiting for the CPU. Let us see the summary of this topic. A process, when it is not executing, placed in some waiting queue. We have seen that there are two major classes of queues in operating system. That is IO request queue and ready queue. The ready queue contains all the processes that are ready to execute and are waiting for the CPU. Also, we have seen that each process is represented by a PCB, and the PCBs can be linked together to form a ready queue, that is a linked list. Long-term scheduling is the selection of processes that will be allowed to contend for the CPU. Normally, long-term scheduling is heavily influenced by resources allocation considerations, especially memory management. And also we have seen short-term CPU scheduling is the selection of one process from the ready queue. So this ends the subtopic of third unit of OSY.